All right, hi everybody. Welcome back. This should be lecture two or so. And today we're going to talk about cells, organelles, which I'll get into, and a little bit about chemistry today. So let's first start with something you should be familiar with, which is a fish. If we zoom into the fish, we can see that the fish is made up of a bunch of smaller, little tiny subunits that we call cells. Now, these are just drawings, but you would actually do this if you had a microscope and you would see the cells of a fish. The cells, of course, are quite small. The largest cells you can actually see with the naked eye, but you usually need a microscope to really see any detail. So let's zoom in more. And at this scale that you see now, we're looking at cells that are probably 400 times magnified. So we've magnified them 400 times larger than they really are, but they're still small. So let's just expand them a little bit so we can go a little bit further. Now we can see, zooming in a little bit more, we have three cells. Basically, the fish is made up of a bunch of these cells bunched together, with certain cells being more specialized than others. But we'll expand on those even more, and let's get down to where we're maybe 300 times the size that they actually are, like that. So now we can see these three cells pretty good. We've zoomed in, and we can start with, no matter what you're dealing with, all living things, whether they're fish or plants or dogs or people, everything that's alive is going to be made up of cells. And there are different kinds of cells, and we can worry about that later. There's different kinds of cells in different organisms, and there's different kinds of cells throughout, say, the fish's body. But again, we can deal with those as we get to them. The cells themselves are made up of smaller subunits that we call organelles, and I'll talk about those as we go. And some of the most important organelles that we should know, which are sort of functional units within the cell, would be starting with the cell membrane, which helps regulate what moves in and out of a cell, such as regulating water or sugar or salt. So the cell membrane is important for controlling that. That allows the cells to stay in homeostasis, and the cells need to stay in homeostasis for the animal to stay in homeostasis so that it stays alive. So a living thing is alive because we've got to keep those cells, or most of them, alive. The cell membrane is also sometimes called the plasma membrane. You don't need to know that, but I'll tell you that just in case you run across it somewhere else. We also have the nucleus. The nucleus is where the DNA or the genetic code is, and this is often referred to as the brain or the control center of the cell. And the genetic code, you probably already know, is the program that controls the cell. So this fish is a fish because the cells in it have this nucleus with a certain genetic code that program it to turn into a fish, mainly by making very specific proteins, and we'll get into that a little bit later on, but that's where that's happening. So the fish is a fish because of that code, and just like you're a person because you have a certain genetic code and you have brown hair or blue eyes or whatever it is, as long as it's genetically inherited, it's inside pretty much every cell in your body, inside that nucleus of your cells, just like it is in the fish. The last organelle that we'll talk about today is what's called the mitochondria, and you can see a mitochondria here. Cells have many mitochondria depending on what the cell does, but the mitochondria is often referred to as the powerhouse of the cell because the mitochondria helps break down food and turn it into usable energy so that the cells can do things like move the fish and that sort of thing. And we'll get into more of that later, but I think that's a good starting point. Now, if we break those organelles down into smaller units of matter or stuff, we can get down to the smallest level, and we call this the atomic level, or the level of which you're looking at atoms. These are about 100,000 times smaller than the organelles that we just talked about. So I'm just going to skip the zooming in part because it gets way too complex. And there are many, many different atoms, but lucky for you, in biology, we only need a few of them that we deal with. So you're not going to have to memorize this whole chart. Now, even the atoms themselves are made up of parts, and those parts have parts, and it goes on, and you start to get into physics and math of the atoms, and we don't really need to go that far. So let's just look instead at one atom first, and that'll be the carbon atom. And carbon and all the other atoms have three parts, and they are called protons, neutrons, and electrons. And the protons are positively charged, the electrons are negatively charged, and the neutrons have no charge. So you can think of a positive charge kind of like a magnet, and the positive charge is attracted to something like the other side of a magnet that has a negative charge. That's a good way to sort of think about that. The protons and the neutrons are in the center of the atom, and the electrons spin around and like a cloud. What we really need to pay attention to, for now at least, is really the electrons and somewhat the protons. We're not going to really need the neutrons, so you can skip those. Carbon has six protons in it, six positive charges, so it attracts six negative charges. That probably makes sense, right? And there are certain rules by which the electrons fill up. So you notice that in this picture, there's two that are in this first ring, and then there's four on the outside. We don't need to worry about that either right now, but what you will need to remember is that carbon has six protons and it has six electrons, and that's going to be important later on. So pretty much all the atoms are different from one another because they have a different number of protons and electrons. And again, we don't really need to worry about the neutrons. So take a look at oxygen here, and here is also hydrogen, and you can see that they have different numbers of electrons. So it turns out that hydrogen has one proton and one electron. Carbon, like I already said, has six protons and six electrons. Oxygen has eight, and nitrogen has seven. Like I said, there's all kinds of atoms, but luckily for you, there's a couple others we'll need later on, but those four atoms represent about 95% of all the atoms that make up most living things. There's a couple of exceptions. We'll talk a little bit about sodium and chloride later on because of salt and the ocean and things of that sort, but that's a really good starting point with just those four. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is look at how these atoms are going to interact with each other, because by themselves they don't really do anything. It turns out the atoms, as we see them above, they're basically unstable. And one of the ways they become stabilized is by sharing electrons with other atoms. So let's start with carbon first. Carbon has, like I said, these six electrons, two in that first energy level, and then it has four on the outside, but it could hold eight, which means that carbon has four spots by which it could share electrons with something. And if we look then at oxygen, like I said, has eight, two in the first, six in that outer one. You need two more. So oxygen could share electrons with in two spots. Nitrogen with seven could share in three spots. So what happens is the electrons are attracted to the atom, but then as the electrons spin around it, there's like a stability that takes place or doesn't. And again, the atom sort of is most stable when it has all the spaces filled up. Hydrogen, with only that one proton and one electron, has a place to share with just one other thing. Now, my guess is right about now, I've probably lost many of you. But don't worry, because what you really need to remember is that because of these open spots, we can expect, in general, hydrogen's going to form one bond, carbon's going to generally form four bonds, oxygen's going to form two bonds, and nitrogen's going to form three bonds. Sometimes atoms will form what we call a double bond, but let's worry about that later on. Let's start with that basic rule of one bond, four bonds, two bonds, and three bonds for these particular atoms. Okay, so take a look at this molecule. By the way, when you have an atom, a single atom, that's called an atom. And when you hook atoms together, those become molecules. So a molecule is not just one atom, but it's multiple atoms that are hooked together. And the more you have, the bigger the molecule gets. Okay? So does this molecule right here look familiar to you? You can see, if you look at it, it's a little overwhelming at first, but you can see the oxygen atom there, and that's hooked to two hydrogen atoms that you can see. They're sharing electrons, and when they're sharing electrons, that sharing is called a covalent bond. So that oxygen there has a covalent bond between one hydrogen and the covalent bond between the other hydrogen. Okay, remember, oxygen generally forms two bonds, right? And hydrogen generally forms a single bond. So here's another example here, and this time we have carbon. Okay, so remember, carbon has six protons and therefore six electrons. So it has places to share in four spots. And again, carbon tends to form four bonds. And in this case, we're looking at carbon forming four bonds with hydrogens. So this molecule, CH4, carbon, four hydrogens, is called methane. You probably heard of that before. It's a gas that contributes to global warming because it is a greenhouse gas. And much of the methane in the U.S. comes from belching, which is burping, and flatulence, farting, that comes from cows. We have a lot of cows in the United States. There's methane coming from the ground, and other sources as well. But kind of one of the funny things that people like to point out is that in the United States and other developed countries where we have a lot of cows, a lot of methane's being produced from the cows. Notice over here, you can see we have methane again, but it's written in a different way. In this case, the line represents the covalent bond. So we still have carbon, and they just put it as a C, and we have our four hydrogens. But rather than draw all the electrons, they get a short way to do it, where they draw carbon and they draw these little lines to show you the four hydrogens and how they're connected. So wherever that line is a covalent bond. Okay, so that'll be the end of the first section on marine cells and chemistry. This lecture might be one worth watching a second or third or fourth time to let it soak in. I will tell you from many years of experience, it's not uncommon for chemistry to be difficult for students in the beginning. And I think a lot of that has to do with our abilities to be able to see or visualize what these atoms look like. This definitely took me much, much longer to learn than, say, understanding food webs or fish behavior. So many biologists find chemistry, physics, and math to be somewhat challenging. So don't worry if this is a little bit more troubling. This is one of those parts in the class where there's a little bit more of a struggle. There are certain parts that are easier and certain parts that are more difficult. And this might just take some of you, maybe most of you, a little bit more time because you'll have trouble visualizing it. Okay, that's it for now. I hope that helps, and talk to you soon.